Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's really my pleasure to be here and to be able to give a presentation. Unfortunately, my luggage didn't arrive, so I have rather informal dressing, but I brought some other ones. But or maybe it's better that I was here without my luggage than that my luggage was here without me. It would have been an interesting talk, I think, with my luggage only. Decisions have to be made. That's the topic of my talk. And it's about the issue of standard setting in the field of educational measurement. And this is my university and my research groups I'm belonging to. Just to introduce myself, I'm a psychologist working in educational measurement. And I feel like Kurt Lewin, educational measurement, I think, is about real life problems. And I think it's good as a psychologist to be there because nothing is as practical as a good psychometric model. So that's my goal, my aim in educational measurement is to provide good models to solve real life problems. Okay. Decisions have to be made. It's about mastery decisions. And where do mastery decisions happen? In high stakes pupils testing, you're doing an exam and the teacher has to decide, do you pass or do you fail? Licensure and certification, like in the US, you have the National Board of Medical Examiners and they decide whether you're allowed to get a license to be a doctor in the US. Or you have master decisions in national or international assessments where you have to decide, does this student really attain the curriculum standards or no? And you have to decide it on the basis of the performance of the student of the test. But you also have to make a decision, what is the minimum performance necessary to be classified as a master? This is the problem of mastery decisions. This is the problem of standard setting. You have this also in international assessments, for instance, the European Survey on Language Competence. Poland participated, as well as Flanders and other parts of Belgium. We have to distinguish different levels of language competence, and hence we have to make a decision which performance on the test corresponds to this level of language competence. So this is mastery decisions. How are we going to make such a decision in a fair way? This is the classical overview of my talk. I start with an introduction and I will end with conclusions. In between, I will give you some examples of the National Assessments of Educational Progress in Flanders. I will give you a sample, but not all of them, of the procedures used, how to classify students, how to determine these cut scores. And then I give you an example of research in which we compared two methods of standard setting, an examinee-centered method and an item-centered method. Okay, your turn. I give you 10 situations. I'm not going to read them because you can read them quicker than I can read them for you. And just think about the number of cases in which you make a mastery decision. Who got zero? Who got more than three? Nobody gets more than three cases? No? Well, we will wait and see if you're that hesitant to think about classifying these as mastery decisions. Actually, there are three characteristics of mastery decisions which we will be discussing in a minute. First characteristic. Already a long made distinction in mastery classification is that mastery can be all or none, versus it can be not a categorical distinction, like you can swim or you cannot swim, but it can also be a continuum of levels. The state view is the categorical distinction. Swimming or not swimming is a qualitative distinction. the applicability of this state view in educational measurement is rather limited. It's limited to specific domains, for instance, mental additions up till sums of sums up till 10. You can consider this as a state view, you can do it or you can't. Or very general domains, and we hope the pilot is really all or none. He can always safely land the plane, or he cannot do it in the correct way. Always, it's an all or none decision. On the other hand, mastery, for instance, in mathematics, seems to be more like different degrees of mastery. Hence, when you want to classify students into a master or not a master, you will need some cut score on this continuum to make the distinction between two classes of students. Actually, the continuum view is generally applied in educational measurement. Second problem, or second characteristic of mastery decisions, if we have this continuum of levels of mastery, our way to classify students into masters and non-masters should be based on a certain criterion. Nedelsky wrote it in 1954. A passing score should be based on the instructor's judgment of what constitutes an adequate achievement on the part of a student, and not, like in norm-referenced measurement, on the performance by the student relative to this, his class, or to any particular group of students. In that sense, the standard to be used for determining the passing score is absolute. If we want to make mastery decisions, they have to be criterion-referenced and not norm-referenced. Well, let's look at our problem again. How many of these are mastery decisions? You were hesitating, but there are only 5 of them that are really mastery decisions. In those blue cases, there's really a problem of getting a degree, reaching some standard, like being able to swim 100 meters or reaching an advanced level of proficiency. There's a continuum level of swimming ability. There's a continuum level of English as a foreign language. But you have to distinguish criteria how, when the performance of the students is acceptable for being classified at the proficiency level. The other examples are not mastery decisions. Of course, getting a scholarship for starting a PhD, you also hope that the students who will get the scholarship have a certain minimum level of ability, but the reason or the method on which we make this decision is after being qualified, it's norm-referenced, only the best students get the degree. Only the best students enter Oxford University, or only the best students are on the school team for a running competition. That is relative decisions. Getting a score of 140 on an intelligence test is really based on a particular example of norm-referenced testing. So, second characteristic, we have to make criterion-referenced decisions. A consequence of this is, given the continuum view of mastery, we have to find out where we put the cutoff. When do we classify a student as having enough mastery to be classified as a master in comparison to the students with lower ability that will be classified as a non-master? As you see on the picture, and as was given as a critique on standard setting in the 1970s by Glass, in fact, standard setting always leads to arbitrary decisions. Where are the decisions arbitrary? They are arbitrary for the students right above or right below the cutoff point. It's a continuum view of mastery, but still we are classifying students, so there is not much difference between the student just passing and the student just failing. So Glass is right, but it's not right. It's not a correct statement for the whole procedure of standard setting. And then the final point is how to set this cut point. A final characteristic, how are we going to decide about this cut point? In fact, a commonly used cut point is you just have to pass or to obtain at least half of the points. Okay, question to you again. Do you think this is a fair rule for making mastery decisions? Well, if you're doubting, I have an example. If this is a fair decision, which of the two would you prefer? Two exams on elementary mental multiplications, but in fact, the one on the left is much easier than the one on the right, so it's much easier to obtain 50% on the left side exam than 50% on the right side exam. Yeah? So it seems not to be a really fair kind of way to set cut scores, but it's based on a certain logic. And what is the logic behind this 50% rule? It's the logic of the domain score. A domain score can be thought of the proportion of items that you can answer correctly from the universe of items. So if we are making a mastery decision on mental multiplications, the domain we are referring to are all possible mental multiplications. Our test is just a sample from it, and so we are using the proportion correct responses on the test, the sample of items from the universe of items, as an estimate of the domain score. And you saw these are two samples of items, but there is certainly not a good reason to take as a cut point the 0.50, the 50% correct responses as a passing rule. For example, we wouldn't like a doctor to know the correct diagnosis in only 50% of the cases. Okay, that's the logic at the person side. At the person side, the level of mastery can vary between 0 and 1. It's perfect mastery, you know all the items correctly. Actually, a 50% cutoff, obtain only half of the points correctly, refers to that you have a 50% probability of mastering a randomly sampled item from the domain correctly. And that's the problem with the doctor. We wouldn't like the doctor to make a correct diagnosis in only half of the cases. So, three characteristics of mastery decisions. First, mastery decisions imply a categorization of a continuous latent variable. Second characteristic, we need to set a passing score. And final characteristic, when making this passing score, we cannot use a general rule of you have to have half of the items correctly. No, when deciding about this passing score, we should take into account the importance of the decision. The mastery decision of a doctor is maybe more important than the mastery decisions we have to make about, well, let's say, a psychologist or whatever. The decisions of the doctor are really important with respect to the life of the patients, but also differences in item difficulty should be taken into account before we can get to such a passing score, a specific criterion. So we have to translate our minimum performance standard in some cut score on the test result. We have to make this exercise before we can make mastery decisions. Okay, let's look at an example of making such mastery decisions in the National Assessments of Educational Progress in Flanders. And this is just a sample of national assessments. Actually, we have two assessments every year. It's schools participating based on a sample, it's not a national exam, and each time we take different subjects. Well, you cannot infer always the subject from the picture, but this is like information processing. This is about listening, reading, but also speaking Dutch, which is our native language. This is about French. different subjects, and we have to make two goals with the mastery, with the national assessments. First, how many students are attaining the core curriculum? How many students are attaining these national curriculum standards? And secondly, what are the differences between the schools, between the classes within the schools, among the students within the classes with respect to those percentage of mastery students? For example, if 90% of the students are attaining the core curriculum, well, it would not be good if those 10% of the students would only go to a specific subset of schools. So we also have to look at the variability among the schools with respect to the students. But for the present purpose, we will focus on the problem: how will we classify students as mastering the curriculum versus students who do not master the curriculum? I will tell you with a very specific and simple example, an example from mathematics in primary education, and there was one scale on numbers and equivalences. There are two attainment targets. What are numbers and equivalences? It's about decimal numbers, simple fractions, simple percentages, the line of numbers, and it's also to be able to determine the correspondence between those different representations of numbers. I give you some examples. This looks like a very easy example, but if you are not able to understand the logic of the decimal numbers, you will think B is the correct response. 8 out of 10, what is the percentage corresponding to this figure? And then the other item is two fractions, which two fractions correspond to this position on the number scale. Different sets, different samples of items from our universe. When are students mastering the attainment targets? Well, in order to solve this issue, we have to think of the fact that we have only a sample of items from the population, that mastery is not the state view, but the continuum view, and so we have to fix a standard, but taking into account differences in difficulty in the items of the test. In order to accomplish this, we make use of a measurement scale. A measurement scale is an item response theory model, and a measurement scale is like a ladder. A ladder on which the items are ordered in increasing order of difficulty, and these are the items. In contrast with the ladder, the distance between the items is not always the same. It depends on the differences in difficulty. Those items are similar in difficulty, but this item is really more difficult, but the difference between those two items and the next item is even higher. A specific characteristic of the measurement scale in IRT is that not only the items are ordered in increasing order of difficulty, but also that the persons, the students, are ordered in increasing order of ability. In fact, a student is placed on that position on the ladder, on the scale, that describes best his or her mastery with respect to the items, and mastery is defined as a probability of success. So items that are below the student are items that the student masters, that there's a high probability of success to solve the item correctly. Items that are above the students are still beyond the scope of the student. The student cannot reach these items standing on the position on the ladder. These are items where the probability of success is lower than 0.50, and the further the item is from the student, the lower the success probability. Why does this help in our problem of mastery decisions? Well, we can ask experts to look at our measurement scale to make a distinction between items that have to be mastered to reach the curriculum standards versus items that are also testing the same domain, but that go further than this minimum standard that we require, given this distinction at the item site, and given that the persons are on the same scale in an IRT model, we can then make a distinction between the persons that reach the curriculum, they have a position higher than the cut score, and persons that do not reach the curriculum, their position is lower than the cut score, their probability of solving an item that is right on the place of the cut score is lower than 0.50. This is called the bookmark procedure of setting a standard. It's a procedure that was invented in the United States by a testing company. It's called a bookmark procedure because the experts are given the items in a booklet, ordered according to difficulty, and they have to place a bookmark on the position where they think the cut score should be. So, this is the bookmark procedure of standard setting applied to our problem, numbers and equivalences. We developed a scale based on a calibration study and testing, of course, the goodness of fit of our model. It's not astonishing, I think, that fractions was the most difficult items and the cheeses was one of the easiest items. We asked experts to make the distinction or to distinguish between items that have to be masters and items that go beyond. And this was the result. 86% of the students master our core curriculum with respect to numbers and equivalences. According to the experts, these are items that have to be mastered, while the fraction item is an item that goes beyond this minimum performance level. Okay, so mastery decisions in national assessments are based on a bookmark procedure, which is done when we have an IRT scale. Well, the IRT scale is, of course, made on the basis of empirical data if we have developed the items, and the items are translations of the curriculum standards that are extensively tested in pilot studies. So after we have the cut score derived in a national assessment, we can look at the performance of the students and then tell something about the performance on their curriculum standards with respect to students who master and students who do not master. So, our summary. Mastery decisions in the national assessment are whether students master or do not master the core curriculum. The criterion is set on a measurement scale by experts who study the items on the IRT scale using the bookmark procedure. They are only given the items, the item content. They are not given relative information about how many students reach this item, how many students perform on this item. So it's really criterion referenced, not norm referenced. And setting the standard is part of a larger process of test and scale construction. And during the process, well, we also have to take into account differences between the judges, because not all judges have the same opinion about the position of the minimum cut score. So we usually take the median of the judgments as the cut score. Okay, so we have already one example of setting a cut score, one way to make mastery classifications. What is a standard setting study? Well, this is the definition. It's the following of a prescribed rational system of rules or procedures resulting in the assignment of a number to differentiate between two or more states or degrees of a performance. And the assignment of a number is passing or non-passing in the case of the national assessments. Given the continuum view, and given the two sides that are involved, we can distinguish between examinee-centered methods and item-centered methods. As you see, the bookmark procedure is at the item-centered method. Why? Because the experts are judging the content of the items, and on the basis of their judgments of the content of the items, the cut score is made. You can also look at examinee-centered methods. I will just shortly describe two methods. The borderline method, for instance, looks at the performance of the students for which experts say we're not sure whether they are reaching the curriculum standards, yes or no. These are the students for which this teacher is not sure about the classification. Is it a master or a non-master? Well, supposedly these students are right, are performing right across the border where we have to set the cut score. These are the students for which the decision is an arbitrary decision. So, for instance, taking the median of the performance of these borderline students can be called a procedure to set a cut score. Another way is the contrasting groups method. The contrasting groups method also starts from a classification of the students into masters and non-masters, usually a classification external to the test. For instance, the teacher knows these students really master the curriculum standards of maths, while these students don't. We look at the performance between those two groups of students, and we then try to find the best possible way to differentiate between those two groups, and that will be our cut point. Note, we will always make classification errors. Again, for students right around the cut score, as some students are classified as a master, but using this cut score, they will be classified as a non-master. On the other hand, some students that were classified as a non-master are now, using the cut score, classified as a master. Item-centered methods, there are really a lot of them. I will only explain the first one, the Angoff method. It's an item-centered method. So what's the idea of item-centered methods? Is that you think of a minimally competent student, a student who is just passing the performance standard. And then in the Angoff method, you ask the experts to judge how a minimally competent student will perform on each of the items. For example, if they are really easy items, you can expect that the experts say that a minimally competent student will have a high success probability on this set of items. If it's a very difficult item, you can expect that the experts predict that a minimally competent student will have a low success probability on these items. Given these probability judgments, we can sum the probabilities, and this will be the cut score on the test. I think I have an example. Which exam do you prefer? We preferred the second exam. However, using the Angoff method, we can give a judgment about the probability that a minimally competent student will make these items correctly. This will lead to a cut score of 3.8 on 4 for the first exam. For the second exam, you see that the probabilities are lower. These are harder items, and hence, in order to pass the exam, you only need to make 3 out of 4 items correctly. So using the Angoff method, you can make a correction for differences in difficulty among different sets of exams. Note, we have to ask the judges to give their opinion about the success probabilities on the items, but in contrast with the bookmark procedure, we don't give them any information about the difficulty of the items. So hence, a critique of the Angoff method was already given in the 80s. It's really a cognitively complex task. Even when you ask experts just to judge differences in difficulty among the experts, they are really not so good in doing this. Well, now they not only have to estimate differences in difficulty, they also have to estimate the probability that a particular student, a minimally competent student, will have a certain success probability on the items. In fact, the probabilistic Angoff also has a deterministic variant. It's called the dichotomous Angoff. In the dichotomous Angoff, we don't ask for probabilities, but we just ask for classifications. Is this an item that has to be mastered versus an item that doesn't have to be mastered? And depending on the position of the minimally competent student, you can have more items that have to be mastered or less items that they do not have to be must. These are examples of item-centered methods. Actually, these are all examples about item accuracy data. I also worked together with Jorge González and Ernesto San Martín from the University in Santiago in Chile on examples or ways to set cut scores for counts data. Counts data, well, what are these? For instance, if you have a reading test, you have several lists of words, and the counts are the number of correctly read words for each list. Or you have a fluency test, you give different stimulus words, and you ask how many synonyms can you generate for each word. Or another example, this is why physical fitness or test lessons of physical education are not always that popular. Test of physical fitness is the number of correctly executed tasks within a certain time period. Do as many push-ups as you can do, sit-ups, rope skipping in 1 minute. And we try to count these data to assess your physical fitness. In the accuracy data, we have the IRT models. Actually, for the counts data, there are also IRT models. It's also a Rush model. It's called the Rush-Poisson counts model. It's not a model based on the logistic regression model, but it's a model based on the Poisson model. You remember the Poisson distribution from statistics. It's the only distribution where the mean and the variance are always equal. This is an example of a modeling of the Rush, I switched on the wrong button. You see, these are the counts data, the number of correctly read words, for instance. We have two tests. One is an easy test. And actually, we counted the number of errors instead of the number of correct responses. That's why you have higher numbers for the difficult test and lower numbers for the easy test. It's the number of errors counted. And this is differences between the subtests, but you can also have differences between the students. Students differing in ability. This is a low ability student, highly error prone student. This is a higher ability student. You see the number of errors we predict the student to make on the basis of the model is much less than for the lower ability student. Also for the Rush-Poisson counts model, we can have standard setting, examinee-centered methods and item-centered methods. Item-centered methods is like the dichotomous Engov. We ask for the minimally acceptable performance of a minimally competent student. For instance, the number of errors that is still tolerable to make to be able to classify it as a master, or the number of successful executions on the test for physical fitness that you at least have to make before classified as physically fit. Okay, different standard setting procedures. Looking at the item side or at the person side, like the IRT-based method or the Engov method, are at the item side, but the first one is IRT-based and the second one is not. And then it always implies a judgment by some experts about a minimally competent student to select the basic items. And as I told you, we have to take into account also differences in severity between the judges. Okay, we have now the tools to look at some empirical studies. In fact, I'm going to tell you only the results of one study, which appeared in the Journal of Educational Measurement. I will also mention the study with the two guys from Chile, which is also comparing an item-centered and an examinee-centered method, but then for the Rush-Poisson counts model. What was the goal of this study? Compare the contrasting groups methods and the Engov methods within with a within subjects design. So controlling for differences among judges, the same judges were performing the contrasting groups method and the same judges were performing the Angoff method. So differences between the methods cannot be due to differences in severity between the two groups of judges. Why are we comparing this? Well, we want to compare this by looking whether the implicit assumptions of both methods are really valid assumptions when we look at the data of these judges. So we will try to model the judges according to the implicit assumptions of the method and see how the judges perform. Let's explain this in more detail. First, the contrasting groups methods. And we have already discussed this. We have masters and non-masters, and we're trying to find the cutoff on the scale. In fact, what kind of variability is available or is present when you look at the scores of these two groups of students? Actually, it's all of the above. Yeah? If we want to model the judgments of the judges, we should take into account that the students that they will be classifying into masters and non-masters will differ in their level of mastery. Secondly, we have to take into account that there is some measurement error involved, that the test results of the students may not be a good representation of their true scores, and that also the judges may make some errors, so we will use a probabilistic model for the judgments. And finally, we also have to take into account that the variability between the scores, why are some judges, some students classified as a master, while other students are not classified as a master, maybe it's because some students were judged by a lenient teacher, while other students were judged by a more severe teacher who just makes less students or classifies less students as a master. We can take into account the variability of the scores and of the data when using a logistic regression model of the judgments. A logistic regression model is just like a regression model, a linear combination of a predictor, and you have an intercept and a weight, but instead of a continuous dependent variable, we have a dichotomous dependent variable, the probability that student P is classified as a master by judge G. Well, because we have a dichotomous data, we have logistic regression. That just means the linear predictor is entered into a certain formula, the logistic function, so that the continuous variable that we have here is transformed into a probability of a measure that only ranges between 0 and 1. Why does this model take into account all the variation that are in the data? The error is already explained by the fact that we model a probability of being classified as a judge, as a master. Differences between the judges are taken into account because the base rate of classifying students as master is taken into account by differences in the intercept of the judges. Yeah, it represents the severity of the judge. If you control for students of the same ability or ability of 0, what is the probability that this judge will classify the student as a master? We also take into account differences between the students, because here is a continuous variable characterizing the level of ability of each student. And finally, we also take into account whether students or whether experts are using the same dimension to classify the students as a master or a non-master as the dimension which is used to obtain the test score. So we also measure the differences between the judges in the strength of the link between the ability estimate and the classification. So this is a good model to see whether the assumption implicit in the contrasting groups methods are really present in the data. If they are present, we should have a positive value of the D parameter, so that the larger, the higher the student's ability, the higher the probability of success. We should also see whether there are differences in base rates by looking at this A parameter. So this is in fact a good way to see, to model the data we have. If we have this data for one judge, and this is the resulting classification curve, the higher the ability of the students, the higher the probability the student will be classified as a master, and Longford proposed to use as a cutoff the 0.50 probability, and this is just the minus the intercept divided by the slope. Looking at differences among the judges, we can have a random effects logistic regression model. You see we have an average parameter for the judges, and how the different judges G differ from this average intercept, and also how the different judges differ from the average slope, and the judges' parameters are modeled as normal distributions. So for another judge, we can see that the probability to be classified as a master has a different shape. Judge B is more severe, he asks a higher level of ability before he classifies students as a master. So, using the logistic regression model, we take into account differences among students in level of mastery. We take into account differences between the judges, actually at two levels, at the level of severity, the base rate, and the level to which, the degree to which they take into account the latent dimension when they are making their decisions. These are the contrasting groups judgments. We can also look at item-centered methods. And instead of doing the probabilistic Angoff method, we used the dichotomous Angoff method. Why? Because from the perspective of cognitive complexity, this is the same type of task as the contrasting groups judgments. You just have to make a classification with respect to the items, into items that have to be mastered and items that do not have to be mastered. Like the contrasting groups methods also ask just for a classification of the students into two classes. Given the similarity between the dichotomous Angoff and the contrasting groups method, we can also use a logistic regression model to look at the responses of the judges and to model the responses of the judges on this task. Again, the probability for an item to be classified by a judge as an item that has to be mastered, given a certain difficulty of the item, should be an increasing function of the difficulties of the items. Yeah? Well, I said an increasing function. Is it an increasing function? What kind of value do we expect for the D parameter? Given that you are modeling items that have to be mastered given a certain ability, what do you expect of the slope parameter? This time, you expect the slope parameter to be negative, because the higher the level of difficulty, of course, the lower the probability that this item is classified as an item that has to be mastered. So it's the same model, but you are expecting the slopes to be negative. If the model of the judgments made by the judges are behaving according to the model that is behind the Angoff judgments. Again, taking into account differences between the judges, we have a random effects logistic regression model. We have an average intercept and an average slope parameter, but there are individual differences among the judges. And if there is a significant, if there is a variance parameter significantly different from zero, we know that there are differences among the judges. So as a summary, also the dichotomous ANGOV judgments can be modeled using random logistic regression, taking into account differences in the items in difficulty, but also taking into account differences between the judges with respect to severity and with respect to the degree to which they take the latent dimension into account. This is the way we proceeded. Where did we apply this method to? It was in the context of the educational attainment targets of primary education. It was the targets on nature, biology. We asked the teachers of the final year of primary education to look at the items of the national assessment and to decide which items have to be mastered to be classified as a master and which items not. But they also had to make a contrasting groups judgment for their students of their own class into students who reach the attainment targets and students who don't. Actually, in Belgium, we don't have central exams, so each school is responsible for giving the degree of elementary education to its students, and the students who do not obtain the degree are given the possibility of 1 year of remedial teaching in secondary education. So the classification we ask from the judges is quite natural for the teachers to make. They already make this kind of judgment into masters and non-masters of their students. These are the numbers we had the data from, and these are the descriptive statistics. In fact, the percentage of items that have to be mastered by the minimally competent student differed between about half of the items that have to be mastered according to one teacher to about all the items that have to be mastered by another teacher. Which is the more severe teacher? This teacher is really having a high standard before a student is classified as a master. With respect to the students, the percentage of masters in the class varied between 20% and 100%. This is the distribution. So this is the 13 classes, 13 teachers classified all their students as a master, and one teacher classified 1 out of 5 students as a master. Your turn again. This teacher that only classified 1 out of 5 children as a master is a severe judge. True, false, or you don't know? Well, no, you don't know, because maybe these are not that bright students in his class. So the teacher is indeed making a judgment with not such a high standard as another teacher who classified 80% of the students. So you should take into account the ability of the students when looking at the classification of judges into masters and non-masters. That's what our model does. These are the results. Actually, we do have differences in intercept and slope parameter. The differences in severity are quite similar between the two methods, and we indeed have a negative slope for the ANGOV method and a positive slope for the contrasting groups method. However, in absolute value, this is much lower than for the contrasting groups method. So it seems that the ANGOV method is a much more difficult method for the judges to do. The relationship between their classification and the difficulties of the items is much lower than the relationship between their classification of students and the performance of the students on the test. So this is in fact some procedural evidence that indeed the ANGOV judgment is quite a difficult task for judges to accomplish. I have one presentation that summarizes all the results. Here you have the ability scale, and the stars are the items. The histogram you see here is the ability of the students, so you see that it's not such a difficult test for the students. And the ability distribution is shifted towards the right in comparison to the distribution of the items. If we look at the contrasting groups, cutoff points, they are quite similar. More variety in the contrasting, in the Angerhoff judgments, the dichotomous Angerhoff. And what is also very clear from the data is that the item-centered method, Angerhoff, leads to a higher cutoff score than the contrasting groups method. So, is this some general finding? Actually, we also performed the same comparison using the same logistic regression model for counts data, and there also we found that the item-centered method led to higher cut scores than the person or examinee-centered method. Discussion: there are differences in slope. Between the Angerhoff and the contrasting groups method are in fact differences in the consistency with which the judges give their judgments. Contrasting group judgments are more consistent with the implicit view, continuum view, the implicit assumptions of the continuum view than the Angerhoff judgments. The Angerhoff judgments show a weaker link, a lower slope. This may be related to the fact that it's difficult to estimate the difficulty, but we are not sure whether or not some of the teachers were actually making validity judgments rather than minimally competent students' judgments. Maybe the 99% was a teacher who was judging, is this item a good item to check the domain of the core curriculum, and he was not really giving an answer. Does a minimally competent student have to be able to solve this item? We also had higher cut scores for the item-centered method in comparison to the examinee-centered method. This may be a finding that is generalizable. As I told you, we also found this in a study for the Rush-Passau-Kantz model. And what is the explanation for this? One possible explanation for the data I showed you is that the Angerhoff method works with dichotomous judgments. Yeah, we saw that the items were quite easy. Well, if we would have allowed the judges to make a probabilistic judgment, maybe they would give a lot of 0.80 probabilities in the probabilistic Angerhoff. Now all these, if you have five items where you have a 0.80 probability, or you have five items where you have a probability of one, if you have the dichotomous version, you have to have five out of five correctly in the probabilistic version for those five items. You only have to have four out of five correctly. So maybe if you have an easy test, the dichotomous Angerhoff just increases the cut score because you're not allowed to use probabilities in your judgment. Another explanation, which is more general, maybe there's a difference when we judge items. We are thinking about the ideal, what students should know, what a minimally competent student should know, where we have more realistic judgments when we are judging students, because then we are not thinking about the ideal, but what is really obtainable with certain students. And so this may also be an explanation why we have lower standards when we are using the contrasting groups methods. They are more realistic, whereas the item-centered methods maybe lead to more idealistic cut scores. The results are also in line with a more general conclusion on standard setting, and that is the conclusion of Jaeger: different procedures leads to different results. And that is one of the conclusions I'll show you in a minute that has been reached on standard setting in the 90s. It's a kind of pessimistic conclusion. Let's look at these conclusions from research. Before the 1980s, this was standard setting was really an optimistic field to work in. Why did they develop the problem of standard setting? Because, it's still some Dutch on it. We had mandated pupil proficiency testing, and we didn't want to have this problem of grade inflation, so we needed to have fixed cut scores. Afterwards, there was more pessimism. Glass, you know, the arbitrary decision man, says setting performance standards is a waste of time, or even worse. It's not really an optimistic decision, the conclusion. And the different procedures leads to different results. Or Shepherd, she was saying, it's cognitively too complex, so avoid setting standards whenever possible. So really pessimistic conclusions. In the 90s, or now from now on, there's some realistic conclusions about standard setting. You can't live with it, but you also can't live without it. We have to find a way out. There's no gold standard, there's not even a silver standard, but we have to make a standard, maybe a bronze standard. We have more conceptual discussions about standard setting. For instance, distinguish between a conceptual criterion, the performance standard, and the cut score, which is an operational criterion. If the judges differ with respect to their conceptual criterion, of course they will have different cut scores. So you should invest time in talking about performance standards. And the only answer on these strange or different results is that you should try to get some coherence in your setting of a standard. And our study tried to contribute to this coherence by looking at whether the judgments of the judges are in line with the implicit assumptions that are part of the standard setting study. And these are some reference works. What is the conclusion for educational practice? Well, I think standard setting should be included in any exam. It's a procedure of accountability. It's not the only procedure we need to have fair exams. Of course, it's also needed to formulate the goals of your exam, the performance standard, to have a good test design, ensure that you have for instance, a stratified sampling of items from the universe of items, that it's not a biased sample. You should also have items of good quality and with good scoring rules. Because if you have bad scoring rules, of course, you can make wrong decisions. As an example of a scoring rule, it's one of the examples I was given as a first-year student at the university. Do you know the law of Gauss of Boyle? Well, maybe it's a long time ago. Your answer may be pressure times volume is a constant. Yeah? Well, if you give this answer, you get 9.5 out of 10 in high school. If you're at university, it should be zero. Because this is not the Boyle's law. The Boyle's law is only valid if you're talking about constant temperature. So setting a standard is fine, but you should also be fair in looking at the scoring rule, and you shouldn't be lenient in giving a correct response to some of the items. It has to be completely correct as well. So let's look at the final decision, the final conclusion. If we have the scoring rules, the best is using an IRT scale and set the cut score. But this is our final conclusion. Setting standards, it's like the union of the mathematician and the poet. Fervor with measure, passion with correctness. This surely is the ideal. Maybe it's the ideal. It's very difficult to obtain. Thanks for your attention. attention.